Hello, everybody. My name is Stratnos, and it's been a little bit of a slow time here in WoW as we wind down season two. You'll notice the vault videos and stuff on this channel have stopped. I did get a pretty cool 450 speed gloves on this character last week, but probably no more videos of that sort until the next patch comes out. And soon there will be PTR and stuff. We'll be having videos of all of those PTR bosses. But just before then, I wanted to make one more kind of theory video, and this one's one I've been cooking for a while. And it's sort of how I think about the game and also just a general thought process that I use a lot. And the idea, I like to call it like bottleneck theory or thinking about, you're thinking about where is the thing in the content you're doing right now? Like, what are you waiting on? What is the part that is the hardest? What is the resource that you're trying to maximize or that you need to maximize? Because when we get started in this game, right, you're kind of, as you're kind of learning to get better, you sort of are just looking at like, your overall damage, maybe in some spots you're changing between single target and AoE, right? But you're trying to optimize that, and then your survivability by generally being good at dodging mechanics and stuff like that. And that'll take you a long way in World of Warcraft. But if you're ever curious, or if you ever start thinking about like going on really high-end content, pushing into Hall of Fame rating, pushing into very high key type stuff, then there starts to become spots where you're going to want to deviate from just whatever the sim or whatever the guide's gonna tell you. And this video, I kind of wanna go through a bunch of examples of where we've done that in the past and why and what sort of things would make us do that again in the future. And maybe that'll help you identify if you're in a situation like that where you can make some sort of change, or it's not even necessarily a change, but sometimes it's just like mid-fight, figuring out what you're focusing on and how you should decide what to do. Because people ask me all the time, like, hey, it's one of the most common questions actually I get about in stream. People ask me like, hey, what's more important, doing damage or doing mechanics? And usually it's people that are hoping to get an answer about doing mechanics because, they want to tell their guild like, hey, look, see, the damage isn't the important thing. And, obviously like doing mechanics is really important, but the real answer is like both are important. And obviously in an ideal world, you would do both really, really well, but we're not all perfect. And so what can be really helpful is identifying if there's a fight or a situation where you need to focus 80-20 on mechanics or 80-20 on damage, because there are different fights that will ask for that, ask for a different ratio of those sorts of resources from you. And if you're able to identify that and then shift your how what you're focusing on, that can kind of let you cheat and get some extra value, be a better raider than if you were just trying to kind of doing your usual thing without thinking about it. This video is sponsored by u.gg/wow, which is another great resource if you're ever looking for places where you're going to deviate from, say, a guide or a sim. This is a really cool resource that, in addition to some awesome data-generated tier lists, you can go and look at classes and specs on specific encounters, and really you can kind of piggyback off the work that a lot of high-end players are doing, especially if you're looking at like later bosses on Mythic. So you can go and you can see like what builds people are running. You can switch it over between raid and M+, specific dungeons, specific bosses. Really good hack for if you're ever doing like especially end bosses, is you can see what people are running on those end bosses and get a really good idea of like what is going to be a worthy, trinket combination or stat priority for your spec to use on specific fights, talent builds for your spec to use on specific fights. If there are a lot of people doing a lot of different stuff, and this talent popularity number is fairly low, or if everybody's doing one thing, and often it'll be something that's different than what the, sim or guide will say, because there is some weird thing like Razageth, you needed like wrecking throw or whatever if you're playing a warrior so you could break a shield, and that kind of stuff is something that you will this website goes a really long way towards helping you do that. But in the rest of the video, we will talk about the ways that you can kind of think about this yourself and think about this in a theory when you're thinking about an encounter or about a dungeon, about anything like that. And even when you're looking at like item evaluation going into a new tier, identifying if a new trinket is something that might be good or situationally good, identifying if some new consumable might be good. This is something where you'll often see a lot of stuff get missed for a while, and then people will start using it because Echo used it in the MDI, and everybody's like, oh, hang on a sec. But this is kind of the thought process that might help you identify those things before rather than after. So let's start off by talking about damage, because damage is the thing that most people care about the most. And even within damage, there's a lot of different ways to optimize it that can be important. So thinking about the ratio between your AoE damage and your single target damage in both a dungeon and a raid setting is something that a lot of people don't think about. Sometimes there's basically people will put on AoE talents if there's AoE, and then they'll put on single target talents if not. The next level up from that is realizing that in a lot of cases, especially in raid, the AoE isn't that important. And the way you can identify this is, do the adds have to die at a certain time? Or is it just good if they die generally? And if so, are they dying at that time? And if the answer is yes, then you shouldn't sacrifice any more single target to do any more AoE. If the answer is no, which often, especially early in progression, it is, then early in progression, you can move some cooldowns around. An example of this would be Sarkareth Phase 2. For a lot of guilds working on Sarkareth the second phase, you know, you're going to be there with 16 people alive, and the adds are going to start to become a problem if you don't kill them. So during progression, shifting a bunch of damage, single targeting the adds, is something that's really good, using cooldowns on them even, instead of on Sarkareth itself. If you're in a pull where three people are dead, that will let you see further into the fight, and that's valuable. But as the fight goes, as you get more progressed there and you start being in P2 with 20 people alive every time, if those adds are dying, you know, at some point you're looking at boss damage instead, and at some point you're looking at your unholy DK and you're telling them, okay, you just focus on the boss, we will take care of this AoE, and you're looking for a good trade-off, right? You're looking for places where you can take 3 DPS off of an ad and put 3 DPS onto the boss. Or in some cases, you're looking for a place where you can take, you know, 2 DPS off of an ad and put 3 DPS onto a boss, and that's like a really good exchange rate. But in some cases, you're even happy taking 3 DPS off of an ad and putting 1 DPS onto the boss, right? And when I'm saying DPS here, I mean literal damage per second amounts, obviously very small numbers, not like number of players, but just like if you could think about that kind of exchange rate of how much damage you're doing to ads versus the boss. Now, in some points in WoW's history, there's even been extreme ratios, like negative ratios, that have been favorable in terms of boss damage versus ad damage. This comes into play whenever there is funnel available and being used. So this happens when there's a boss that has ads that don't need to die, that don't do anything, or that can be kited. And then there's a boss that you care a lot about boss damage on. In those cases, there are often specs, like Enhancement Shaman, Frost Mage, Subtlety Rogue, that'll get 20, 30, 40% more damage onto the boss if they can have extra targets nearby to generate single target damage off of. And so in those cases, if somebody in your raid was like, hey, I can do 10% more boss damage if I start AoEing and doing a bunch of damage to these adds, you'd tell them, no, don't do that, because then our sub rogue is going to stop doing 40% more damage. Or in the case of pre-nerf back in 8.0, 100% more damage to the boss. That was the big example of this was Zul back in BFA, in Uldir. Zul would summon these little adds that just kept respawning, and you just kite him around, and you would just use them to do big damage to the boss by having the sub rogues funnel out of them. And if anybody else in your guild killed them, and I don't think they even respawned, they just got summoned more frequently. Or they heal themselves, okay. But yeah, you didn't want to actually have anybody else kill them. You just wanted the sub-rogues to be having the 100% uptime on AoEing them. Now, in Season 1 of BFA, there was also a dungeon, Shrine of the Storm, where you would sometimes have these pulls where you would take, like, this... You'd kill these mobs or something like that, right? And then you could, like, take droplets onto the first boss. And these droplets also didn't do anything, and your sub-rogue could also get funnel out of them, right? They could get combo points and do extra single target out of them. And in this case, because the subtlety rogue got such a good ratio, right? Every single extra mob here was giving them so much more single target damage, it became worth it for everybody else to actively not AoE them. So you would see Havoc Demon Hunters, good Havoc Demon Hunters on that were, you know, playing for the team here, would I-beam off into nowhere, just so, like, they would I-beam from sort of inside the boss's hitbox out to the side so that they didn't hit any of the droplets, so that the droplets wouldn't get killed, so that your sub-rogue would keep getting more damage onto the boss. And that's an example of, like, you would never think of doing that if you were just kind of playing in a pug, playing by yourself. But as you start pushing up in higher level content, that's the sort of thing where you sort of identify what is important here. The droplets are not important. Them dying sooner doesn't make the dungeon any safer. They're not going to ever be the last things to die on this pull. They're literally free damage for my sub-rogue. I should accept some annoyance, and I should even accept a DPS loss if I need to keep those alive so that we get more boss damage as a group out of it. Now, another case of different types of damage having different values and often deviating from what a sim might tell you to do or how to play is execute damage. Execute damage is historically a very valuable type of damage because there are a lot of fights where damage before a certain point in the fight is irrelevant or close to irrelevant. We talked about this in one of my previous videos about you know, damage, identify, like optimizing damage on a boss fight and thinking about that. And you can go there if you want to see some examples of why there are some fights where it is generally true that you don't have important damage early on. But an example of that would be like Sire Denathrius, right? Sire Denathrius phase one, up until 70% health. Damage doesn't help that much because you kind of want to stop damage and push at a certain point anyways. So if somebody came up to your guild and was like, hey, I will give you this, I will give you one damage below 70% health in exchange for you giving me five damage above 70% health, you would take that deal a lot, right? You would accept that many times. That would be a good thing to do up until you started getting to a point where it's like, okay, we actually do still need to do enough damage to make this push up in P1. And so that is something that you can do with talent trees pretty often. Pretty often there are some places where, you know, a sim is never going to have you take like a 5% overall damage loss to shift damage from P1 to P3 in a fight, but that can often be very worth it depending on the sort of fight they design. And that's why it's important when you are looking at a fight to identify if this is a fight where, you know, damage stops at a certain point and becomes irrelevant, execute damage becomes extra valuable. Dragonflight, so far, we had a little bit of that. So Razageth, for instance, damage wasn't super relevant above 65. It was during progression, and same on Sire Denathrius, it was during progression until you could make that push reliably. But then once you started stopping damage, you wanted to start holding cooldowns there, and that would be a point where it's like, okay, if there are talent builds you can play that'll give you more damage later, you know, do that. There weren't really huge examples of that on that fight, though. And Sarkareth is a great example of a fight that you can kind of do this because you get the haste buffs in the later parts of the fight, but for the most part, one point of damage on Sarkareth is the same value whether it's in P1, P2, or P3, which I personally prefer fights like that because I don't really like optimizing for, you know, stopping damage in P1 and doing more damage in P3, but they often do design fights like that, so it's good to be aware of. Okay, another thing to think about is the trade-off between DPS and survivability and DPS and mechanics. Some of this comes in the form of how you play. And so this can just be on a boss fight. You can identify, especially again, if it's a damage stop boss fight, if you know you're stopping damage anyways, don't greed for extra globals in the earlier phases, right? Don't stay in for one more global so you can do a little bit more damage in P1. If you're going to be stopping damage anyways, just go and do the mechanic safely, right? And live, right? Make sure you don't wipe the raid, focus on the mechanics. If on the other hand, it's a fight like Sarkareth where every point of damage matters, you know, you got to be greedy to some extent, obviously, you know, try not to screw up and wipe the raid, but greeting for globals becomes much more important on a fight or in a phase in a fight where every point of damage matters, right? You don't want to make that same trade-off there. But if you were fighting a boss like Echo of Neltharion and your guild has been pushing at 34% with the shield up every single pull for the last 10 pulls, just go out early with every mechanic. Like if you got a volcanic heart, just focus only on that. Don't even worry about what kind of damage globals you're doing while you're moving, if there's any chance that it might cause a wipe, because that's just not a good trade-off, right? You should be focused in P1 and P2 of Echo of Neltharion on boss damage and doing your mechanics, right? And if you can ever exchange any amount of brain power off of boss damage and onto those things, that's a good deal on a fight like that. Not true on a fight like Sarkareth, where it's just all, you know, blast the boss the whole way through. Damage on the boss is always relevant. Similarly, you can make this sort of trade-off in your itemization choices, your talent choices, and your consumable choices, which often don't really get thought about that much at lower levels of gameplay, but this is the sort of thing where, especially if you're doing mythic progression or high-end M+ progression, you're going to want to be thinking about these sort of options that your character has. And there's a lot of different things you can try and optimize for if you are looking to make a trade-off away from sim DPS and towards some form of survivability. And it's interesting because when we talk about survivability, there are several different types of survivability. So one is trying to have the largest effective health pool against a one-shot so that you can avoid getting one-shot by certain big blasts of damage. This tends to not be how raid really operates these days. Raid will rarely kill you from 100 to 0 with one damage instance. Sometimes it will. You know, Sarkareth, you'll die from 100 to 0 on Sarkareth, but usually that's because you're like standing in a, you know, searing bomb in P1, or you stood in something, right? Like often in Sarkareth, if you're dying to unavoidable damage, it can be over like 0.5 seconds, but it's rarely one single damage event kills you. In M+, that's a little bit less true. In M+, if you're pushing really high, you'll often reach a point where there comes a certain mechanic that will just kill you. from 100 to 0. So like Infuser, Saria on Fortified, Inundate, right? This mechanic, for example, in Halls of Infusion is one that can be like that. Brackenhide Hollow, I guess there's not really, but sometimes, you know, if you're getting the initial hit even of the Frenzy before they nerfed it, or a Totem exploding, I guess those aren't really quite in that one-shotty range, but you can find these sorts of mechanics in the dungeons where it's like, yeah, you know, this is going to one-shot me. Vortex Pinnacle, last boss here when it chain lightnings you, especially, that one's especially nasty because that's like one-shot level damage and there's raid damage going out at the same time. And so in these cases, if you're thinking about how do I survive against a straight up one-shot and 100 to 0 one-shot, then you want to be looking at things that increase your effective health. So this is like versatility as a stat is something you can always index further into in a situation like this. That can be a good trade-off. Taking off items like the Sarkareth Cloak that sim well, but that aren't giving you stamina. Stamina is effective health, right? Avoidance, if a mechanic can be reduced by avoidance, putting on some extra avoidance gear can be really valuable. On some fights, avoidance isn't that good. On some fights, avoidance doesn't work on that much. And this is another spot where sponsors of this video, UGG, you can go check and see if people are using avoidance or speed or whatever enchants on a certain fight to give you a little bit more of an idea there. Another option is something like File of Icy Preservation. This is something that we didn't see too much use of, and we still don't, because it's, you know, you're taking up a file slot, which is a reasonably high opportunity cost here. You could just have a Tepid Verse here giving you a solid amount of damage reduction across your whole health bar. But Icy Preservation says damage taken is decreased by 5% while over 50% health, but increased by 5% while under 50% health. So if you're at full HP, you know, this is a 5% damage reduction against, say, a one-shot, right? This can let you survive a, you know, half a key level higher one-shot from a boss or something in a dungeon, which is a lot. That's a lot of damage reduction from a file. It's less useful when we start instead thinking about you're taking five hits over 0.5 seconds that are taking you from 100 to 0, because, you know, this all cancels out in the case that that half the hits are below 50% health. But if you're trying to live a one-shot, an effect like this can be really valuable. Similarly, Choker of Shielding, this is something that doesn't really get used because, again, high opportunity cost. On the live servers, you'd have to craft it, and generally crafting a situational... The kinds of people who are doing the sort of content where you would really want to min-max something situational like this don't have access to a lot of embellishment crafts during the time period, the Race to World First, where something like this would be useful. I firmly believe that you would see people experimenting with this in the Race to World First if they had unlimited access to whatever embellishment stuff they wanted, but they only have like one spark or two sparks for the first week, so obviously they're going to put it on some kind of damage effect, some kind of high-level weapon or something like that, right? And not put on a Choker of Shielding instead. But this is an effect that can give you further one-shot protection, right? Give yourself a shield against a one-shot. That can be nice. Obviously, talents, class effects, those sorts of things can be really valuable too, and is often an easier way to solve getting one-shot, right? Press a defensive is one of the easiest answers to a lot of things. But this sort of effect, you know, it's worth thinking about if you're ever in a spot where you're really trying to pull out every stop to survive a one-shot, especially if there's a boss fight or something that's just casting them frequently at you. Again, the Inundates and Halls of Infusion, a good example of this, where it's like, hey, I need to live, you know, 8 of these over the 2-minute period. I'm gonna run out of defenses eventually. Let's add one more to the list of what I have here. Undulating Spore Cloak, on the other hand, does not give you one-shot protection. Undulating Spore Cloak is fantastic in that spot that I was talking about where you take 5 hits that kill you over 0.5 seconds, because after the third or fourth of those, your Spore Cloak is going to proc, give you a big shield, and you're never going to be in any danger of dying. Your shield is like barely going to be broken. You're going to be chilling. You're going to be really happy. Spore Cloak, fantastic item in that sort of case. Sarkareth often does damage on the group like that, and Spore Cloak looks really good at reducing random deaths in a spot like that. But against a one-shot, this isn't providing you any value, right? This is, aside from the versatility and the stamina on the item, and I guess the armor, if it's a physical hit, then this is not actually a helpful effect there. Which leads to some people being like, hey, why don't people use Choker of Shielding instead of Undulating Spore Cloak? But you've also got to factor in the brain power tax. This is a passive. And this is an active, right? So a passive thing, you know, there's a reason that airbags and cars are a passive proc and not an active proc. You don't have to press a button as you're getting into a crash to save yourself with an airbag. It's much more valuable if something like this will proc for you, especially as you get out of the like really best few people in the world that would be capable of, you know, pressing the choker of shielding 90%+ of the time that they needed to. So another important variable to think about with all of these sorts of things is how much brain power is this asking of me? And do I have any to spare? Which, you know, a lot of people don't like thinking in those terms because people kind of like just thinking, yeah, I'll do it. I'll play better. But realistically, you have a limited amount of that resource as well. Another case to consider is the iced file of corrupting rage. So this, for a lot of classes, is your best DPS file. But there are some cases where you need to be careful of using it. Now, they buffed it, so it's after suffering 400% of your health and damage, you take 25% of your health as nature damage over 15 seconds, after which the cycle begins anew. Now, the downside of this file, especially pre-buff, it didn't usually end up being that it would kill you, although, of course, it's less survivability than a tepid verse or even an elemental whatever focus file. But the downside often was, if this thing is proccing all the time, while you have these 15 seconds going, you're not getting the crit. And so it's actually going to underperform, depending on the uptime of this, the offensive value might underperform the tepid verse. And if the offense is ever underperforming tepid verse and you're taking damage instead of getting extra damage reduction from the verse, it looks really bad. But ever since they buffed it to 400%, you know, a lot of DPS players are not going to go through 400% of their health bar many times over the course of the fight. And so this ends up often being a pretty good trade-off, as long as you're not dying to, you know, taking 25% of your health over 15 seconds, you are quite a bit squishier while that is happening. So this sort of effect, I've seen people call this like really reckless to use, but I really don't think it is. I don't think it's that bad. And I think this is one of those cases of like, you know, maybe the pre-buff version was a little bit more suspicious to use frequently, but I think if crit's your best stat and using something like this, like, you shouldn't think of this as, again, the actual exchange rates matter a lot. That's something that all of the things I've talked about in this video, it really matters what the actual deal you're being offered is, right? How much survivability am I being offered for damage? Because even in these fights we're talking about where it's like, oh yeah, you would take a trade-off of damage for survivability. You would take a trade-off of execute damage for non-execute damage. The actual ratio matters a lot. That's part of the reason that Subrogue in BFA season one got away with so much stuff like Demon Hunter's eye beaming off into nowhere was because it was actually so worth it. We can actually look at this over on warcraftlogs.com. It's one of my favorite little graphs. Let me see how quickly I can go find it, because I've looked at this from time to time. Battle for Azeroth. Not Nyalotha. This was Uldir. And we're looking at Zul statistics. Now, hang on. We want all percentiles going back the entire tier. 8.0. Damage to bosses. Yeah. So this was, again, you can see like Subrogues are doing double damage, right? Double damage to the boss of any other class in this case, right? And when the spec works that well at funneling off of things, then it starts to become worth to make, you know, serious trade-offs, right? These days now, if there's a spec, they nerfed this a lot, right? If there's a spec that's doing 50% more damage or 20%, then it becomes a lot less worth it to do stuff like intentionally, like, not pulling those droplets earlier and pulling them onto the boss in Shrine of the Storm, right? You gotta actually be aware of what the ratios you're being offered are. And that's, I think, a really important thing when you're considering an item like Corrupting Rage and Tepid Verse, is how much actual more DPS am I getting out of this, right? If this is 5 DPS more than a Tepid Verse versus 500 versus 5,000, those are very, very different situations. And you know, if it's the 5 DPS more, you would almost never wear it. If it's 5,000, you would almost always wear it. And if it's 500, it's going to depend on the fight, right? And you'd probably usually wear it, but it depends exactly on the situation and whether it's a fight where you care about the damage or not. And that is, I hope, something that this video will help you identify and think about, because it's often true for different guilds that different bosses have different profiles. So if your guild is just good at damage, versus if your guild kind of sucks at damage but is good at surviving, then whatever you're in low supply of is going to gain value. And you start thinking like, okay, you know, hey, we're never having trouble with this damage check. Let's cut some, like, I'm going to play more defensively. I'm going to play more mechanically as well. That's another thing when you're thinking about this trade-off is like, who's going to be the best player in the raid to go and do this job? And should it be me, right? That's, I think, anytime you see somebody like assigned to run and do some annoying job and lose some damage, you're also kind of applying this theory and thinking about the trade-off. which player in the raid is going to lose the least damage and be at the least risk of dying if they go and run this bomb from point A to point B, right? Like that kind of stuff. You want to, again, just actively think about, right? Don't go on autopilot, especially as a guild, if you're doing guild kind of level strategy. If you've wiped to a mythic boss and you're thinking about what are we going to change for tomorrow night, I hope that this is a framework that can let you make some useful decisions there. And if not, even if you're not, you know, mythic raider, not any interest in any kind of high-end gaming, I hope this video was interesting. I hope that the thought process was cool to hear about. I always find these sorts of videos about other games interesting to watch, so I figured I'd make one for WoW. Hope you enjoyed the video. Remember to hit sub and like and all that stuff. I will see you for some PTR content hopefully very soon. And yeah. Bye.